Namaste, Sakshi, Manasakshi. I am Priya Goteti. Welcome to Immigration Talk Show with Solicitor Dr. Srinivas Kaveti Garu from Kaveti Law Firms. Please note that Sakshi TV now has 5 immigration shows Monday with Somi Reddy Law Firms, Tuesday with Kaveti Law Firms, Wednesday with Prashanti Reddy Garu, Thursday with Chan Parvathaneni, and Friday with Bhanu Ilinder. Please tune in to ask your questions. If you're an immigration attorney and would like to join our special shows, please contact usa@sakshi.com or call us at 866-725-7441. Before we begin the show, please note that the information provided on this show is only for general information only and not for any legal advice. Sakshi TV or its agents are not responsible for use of this information. For any special legal advice, please contact the attorney directly, that is the Kaveti Law Firms. Firstly, again, hearty congratulations for opening 2 new branches, Kaveti Garu in UK. And today our topic is like understanding UK student visas. And welcome to our show, Kaveti Garu.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, Priya.
So what is UK student visa?
It is similar to the US student visas. First of all, you can also go for some, bachelor's degree or a master's degree, or even a PhD. You can also go for a small 6 months to 8 month courses in UK. It's similar to a US model. First of all, you need to have an offer letter, which is called, confirmation of admission in an approved school. That's what we use in America. It's called approved schools by the immigration. Similar to that in UK, there are called licensed schools given by the Department of Home. So that school has to give an offer letter to you. It's a confirmation of acceptance. Then once you have an acceptance, you have to show that you have a financial ability. You have to have TOEFL or English or some English tests. And then you should show that you are clean with TB, tuberculosis, that you don't have no problem health-wise. And you'll have to give a fingerprint, biometric. You have to show that you don't have no criminal cases. And then you are showing that how many months course you're going and what is the relevance, why you're going. So if you fill up all those application forms online, they will process in 3 weeks to 6 weeks time. And your UK student visa will be approved. The beauty in UK student visa is your dependent can also come and join you, and they can work full time. That is the beauty in UK. In America, we don't have that facility that if a dependent comes on an F2, you don't have a right to work. The other thing in UK student visas, you have a right to work outside the campus 20 hours. But if you compare with America, you can only work in the campus 20 hours. So that's the difference between the UK student visa and work rights and US.
Okay. So who is eligible for UK student visa?
As I said to you, UK, it has to be, it can be a certificate program. It can be a bachelor's degree or a master's or a PhD. If you see America, America has been giving I-20s or international admissions for even high school students. But that facility is not there in UK. If you want to study until 12th, you cannot go to UK for studying that because most of the schools in UK are run by the government. I mean, of course, their private schools are also there and people also go for private schools too. But international students, people come to UK for studying bachelor's, master's. The requirement is one has to have English proficiency. If you don't have English proficiency and if you don't have finances, you're not qualified. And if you have these things and you have to show your transcripts, that means you have to show that you have your 11th and 12th, you're going for bachelor's degree. And you have to have a confirmation from the university or a school. And then you can go, no problem. But if you have some health issues or any criminal background issues, then you will not get it. For example, sometimes people get deported from other countries and they try to go to UK. If they have any criminal history, they will not be entitled to go. So these are the qualifications.
Okay. So how to apply for student visa, UK student visa?
It's online. The beauty is you don't have to go for the embassy interview. You can still get your visa by filling up forms online, submitting everything online, and by indicating that you already paid the school fees. See, the difference between the US system and UK system, in US, when you get an I-20, you come to US, you come to America and pay the fees. But in terms of UK, you have to first pay the fees, everything upfront first. Then only you will get acceptance and then you can go. So once you go, you can, once you finish your bachelor's or a master's, you can also convert your visa to work permit and you can stay. And if you continue to work for 5 years, you can apply for your indefinite to leave. You can file for a permanent residency and you can live in UK. So that's the process for a student leading to a work permit.
So how long will we get the student visa in UK? Like the tenure of the visa?
Right. It's maximum 5 years. You cannot stay more than 5 years on a student visa. But whereas in US, again, when you see people are in US for 8 years, 10 years on a student visa during the study. But there's a restriction in UK. You can only stay up till 5 years.
Okay. So what documents do we require to apply for UK visa?
And as I said to you, first is your transcripts, educational certificates, passport, and medical clearances, your fees, you know, that you pay the fees, sometimes affidavit of support, or even bank statements. And if anybody is sponsoring you from any parts of the world, they will give you a sponsoring letter or an affidavit of support. And if you're self-sufficient, for example, if there is any loan is being sanctioned by the bank, you can have that document. And if you see in Telangana or Andhra or even in India, there are some scholarships and there are some loans or there are some reliefs and grants given by the government where you can also go to overseas by the government. Because, for example, if you see Andhra, there's a Jagan also has a program. He used to have a program for foreign education, same as Telangana government had that. So even, you know, central government has some certain schemes, certain a private, you know, under the CSR programs like Tatas and Billas and Jindals, they have programs that if anybody wants to go overseas under the CSR programs, and if you have those evidences saying that you got some scholarships or grants or any international scholarships, if you file all of that, those are the financial documents. So basically, whatever for other countries, a similar thing is, you know, passport copy, educational certificates, admissions from the school, confirmation of, you know, acceptance, and your medical, as I said to you, tuberculosis. And if you have any, so let's say if you have any criminal case, if this case has been dismissed, so some sort of a court dispositions, and your, you know, background, basically, your English proficiency. If you have all of that, you can apply.
So like you said, we need to pay the tuition fees upfront. So is that just the amount that we need to show to UK, or do we need to show any other money that we have for the UK visa?
No, I mean, they have made a distinction that somebody is going to London, they should have a living expenses most close to £1,300-£1,400. And other cities, they said £700-£800 you should show. Not only school fees, but you should also show your living expenses during your course. And the other thing is you should also pay for your insurance before you go there. So that once you go there, it's like a surcharge, health surcharge. You pay that, you go there, and you can avail the facility of hospitals and the GPs. These are practitioners, you know, doctors, these are doctors just like physicians in America. You can go and see them. You get a card so that you can get some treatment for you and for your spouse and children as well.
So while I'm on student visa, is it just only 20 hours that I can work outside, or is there any other work that I can do on UK student visa?
If your holidays times, you can work full time, but overall it's 20 hours a week. But your spouse can work full time. They get a full-time work permit, which is good. And your children can also go to school And they can also avail the facilities of insurance and hospitals.
So can, like you said, the spouse can also work if we come on student visa. So what are the documents that is required for the spouse or the family to join when we are going on UK student visa?
Well, normally they look at the passport and marriage certificate, if they have children, birth certificates, and the basic background, you know, that the spouse will be able to support your family, and financial documents, again, that you're self-sufficient, you will not be a public charge, that you can survive on your own if you're going to London. As I said to you, the limitation is 1,400-1,500 for one person, pounds, and if you're going for another small town, less money. So you have to show bank, you know, that you have ability to pay, you have ability to live there. So those are the things, yeah.
So what happens if my UK student visa is refused?
You can appeal. That's another beauty in appeal. There's an appeal process. You can make an appeal again. You can request them to reconsider. If they have said that they're not convinced with certain documents, you can submit those documents and reapply again.
This is different than the US student visa or similar to student visa?
Yeah, US student visa, once your visa is refused, there is no appeal process. But when there is a change in circumstances, you can go back to the embassy and apply. So there's a slight variation. You know, the dynamics are different, but it's mostly you can again go and apply to US. And but there should be change in circumstances. But in UK, if they are saying that we are not convinced with your, you know, maybe your ability to pay and your course, you know, maybe some schools are not, you know, they don't have good reputation, or with your education, let's say if you're a speech pathologist, if you're going to study a law, it's a different thing. So they want to see you're going to pursue higher education and the relevant education. It has to be justified.
Mm-hmm. So what is the graduation route, like post-study work, how it will be in UK?
Right. If you have a bachelor's degree or a master's degree, you can apply for a post-study work permit for 2 years. And after that, just like in America, we have OPTs similar to that in UK. They're called post-study work permit. So that means after the education, you don't have a sponsor. That's the beauty of UK. In US, for example, if you want to take an OPT, occupational training, you have to have an offer letter from the e-verified company. But over there, you don't need that. You can just make an application on your own online. You can get your work permit for 2 years. You don't need a company to sponsor you. That is a beauty.
And here in US, like if we come on H1 or if we have that, we cannot work in, like there's a minimum pay wage that we need to maintain our visa. Is it similar, like even after we get the post-work thing, do we need to maintain that minimum wage level in UK?
See, if you see all this Western world, there is a prevailing wages that they cannot be exploited. If you're a foreign worker, you cannot be exploited by paying less. They have to pay as per the minimum wage requirements in UK. The way, for example, if an employer is hiring a local British person, and if you're a student and you completed your master's, so they have to pay what they're paying the local, you know, British person. So there's a prevailing wage. Yes, there are requirements. They cannot exploit you and treat you like a slave. Yes, there's a minimum wage requirements in UK as well.
So how can I extend my student visa?
Once you complete your course, let's say you finish your bachelor's, you want to do a master's or you want to do a PhD, you can extend your stay until 5 years. The schools will help you, the solicitors will help you. Online, you can also get information. The home office, locally, you can walk into a home office and find out and do it. You know, here in America, it's not that easy. You walk into an immigration office and find out, but you can make a phone call and find out, or online resources are there. Similarly, there are home office has got information, everything online. So they can do it on their own.
So the maximum tenure on student visa is just 5 years. Even if I wanted to extend further, it's only up to 5 years. So I can't, after completion of 5 years, I can't say that I wanted to do more PhD, like, you know, another PhD, I wanted to extend my student visa. Is it possible?
Well, I mean, you know, 5 years is the cap, which they said. And for example, if you want to work as a, on a research program or a researcher, there are other visas available under the Home Department rules. You can convert into as a researcher's visa. So, I mean, and there's a restriction, yeah.
Okay, so can I switch from one visa to another visa instead of like research visa, like any job permit visa, work permit visa?
Yes, you can convert into from post work permit. You can apply if there's any company willing to offer you a job. They will sponsor you for a tier two visa. It's called tier two visa. Something like an H-1B in America. Yes, they can get a tier two visa. It'll be valid for 3 years.
So here in USA, the dependents, whoever works, they need to have the EAD card. But in UK, like right from the beginning, once they enter, they can start working. So they do also have like this EAD card or something, which is dependent upon the like the spouse who is coming on a student visa, or
you get the card. Yes, they do have a work permit. And normally what happens, once you go there, you'll also, just like in SIN number here, social security number, they get a national insurance number. The students also get for 20 hours, and dependents also can apply for SIN number. In the passport, in the visa itself, the requirements and the regulations are mentioned. If you go to a national insurance number, which is like a social security office, they issue you a SIN number, national insurance number. A SIN number is also called in Canada. So you basically, you go to the, and you show that to the employer, they will allow you to work. That a national insurance number will allow you to work.
As long as the primary person visa is there, we can work until that time.
Yes, that's correct.
And if at all the dependent wants to file another visa during this period, can they file it?
Yes, they can also change their visas, dependents. If they get any visa jobs or if they want to pursue anything, research, yes, they can also change. The beauty is, you know, you can apply in-house in the country, and they will change it by the Home Department of Home. Immigration is called Department of Home in UK. They will change it and they will assist you. Yeah.
Okay, we have this 5 years a student cap, right? So if at all the some student comes to UK, they study for 3 years, then they go back, then they can come back again and file again for 5 years, or this 3 years is considered and they can only do it for next 2 years?
Yeah, they can come every time they go. If there is any intermittent break, then you go back and come back again, you can still stay 5 years.
Okay. So what would be the major difference between US student visa and UK student visa?
As I said to you, the dependents can work. That is the beauty. And if you work in, let's say if you're working in UK for 5 years, husband is studying and wife or husbands are working 5 years continuously on a work permit. If you work for 5 years continuously, you can apply for, you know, indefinitely, which is a PR. So that's the reason many people, when they go, wives are studying for 5 years and husbands are working, and like an IT job or any other job, because they have 5 years of tax returns and 5 years of pay stubs and they're working 5 years, they're entitled to apply for an indefinitely, which is like a PR. So that's what many of our Indian kids are going, wives are going to school and husbands are working for 5 years. And of course, kids also get into admission to school. And insurance has been taken care of. Both the spouses will have insurance, and you know, they enjoy everything except right to vote. They can also buy a property. Many people are even buying property. But when you see in America, people are more skeptical of buying real estate on an H-1B. But that's not the case in UK. People are buying properties. Students are also buying properties. And they're also starting some businesses as well.
Oh, as a student, can we start a business? Because I think in US, it's not possible to start a business when you're on a student visa. But in UK, is it possible?
Yeah, there are models, because if your husband is on a student visa and the wife is on a full work permit, and she can start up a company and they can do business. Yes.
Okay. The major difference is like spouse can work and we can like staying 5 years, we can apply for PR. So do we need a sponsor to apply for, like in US we need some sponsor to apply for green card. So for UK to apply for permanent residence, do we need any sponsorship?
No, you can apply on your own. That is the beauty. You don't need a sponsor. Just like in US, we are working for a company like a slave until you get your green card. But in UK, there's nothing like that. You can apply on your own. You don't need a sponsor. You have to be working. You should have tax returns. You should be working. And you should be paying taxes.
Okay. So mostly when students are from India, they speak multiple languages and they may not be proficient in English. So to apply for student UK student visa, English is like a mandatory one that they need to do it, or can they do it with any other language like French or some other language and apply for it?
No, English, you have to have English proficiency because it's an English country and there's no French and everything. It's an English. You know, if you're not, let's say if you're coming from some African country, your French Creole speaking country, you want to come and study English in that country, then you can come for language studies. There are a lot of students from Africa and Spain, Spanish countries from South America, they go to UK to study English. So once they complete their English proficiency, 6 months to 1 year, then they can get into diploma courses or certificate programs or bachelor's or master's. Yeah. They go for English. They can do it.
Yeah. So for someone who is not proficient in English, they can try applying for an English school in UK and first get an English degree, then they can apply for some other course that they wanted to do.
Yes, that's correct.
Got it. So any other differences that we see apart from that spouse being working in UK, whereas US, the spouse cannot work. So any other differences that we see majorly, like refusal rate, US refusal rate and UK refusal rate for student visas?
UK refusal rate for student visas are very negligible. And because you're not going for the interview, based on your documents, they will stamp your visa and send you the passport home. So whereas USA, you have to go for the interview. And it is a discretion of the officer. Over there, of course, there's a discretion of the officer, but it's all online. And if you fulfill certain criteria, you get your visa. But over in America, even if you fulfill certain criteria, it is a discretion of the officer. If the officer thinks you're not eligible, then they can deny. And there's, the denial rate for US is very, very high as compared to UK. The other beautiful thing is, in US, when people come on a student visa, they have to buy a private insurance for their wife and children. But over there, when you're going to UK, the schools will charge you a surcharge, health surcharge. And once you go to UK, you and your family and children can avail the medical facility. That's the biggest thing in UK, because it's a national health system, NHS. So the government provides all the, your health facilities. Let's say husband and wife goes there and the wife becomes pregnant. Over there in UK, the national health system helps you because you can go and take the treatment and have delivery in the hospital. But whereas in America, you have to take a private insurance that costs thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. And if you don't have a medical insurance, how are you going to survive? And it's not mandatory. For example, if you're going to a school in America, the school is not charging you any insurance fees cover. It is optional. You want to buy an insurance cover from the school for group insurance, it's your own option. Or you want to buy an insurance also, it's optional. There are many students in America, we don't even have medical insurance many, many times. It's not mandatory. But over there, it's mandatory. You have to pay the surcharge before you go there. So that's the difference, major difference.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of difference because in US, we spend a lot of money and it's optional. But in UK, it's It's not optional, it's a mandatory that they gave us like a surcharge. The other thing on the UK student visa, like here in US, after we complete the US visas, like they have to apply for OPT, they need a sponsor, and to apply for H-1B, they need a sponsor. But here, if they come on UK, they don't need any sponsors and they can directly apply, and the denial rate for work permit is also very less, correct? They can apply by themselves.
You're right. Because work permit, to get a tier two visa, you should have a sponsor, of course. That's again all filed online. And within a few weeks, they get approved. But enforcement is very strict in UK. For example, if a company sponsored some employees, they're doing audit, they're coming and checking up whether these guys are working. But how many times that happens in America? Hundreds of companies, H-1Bs, thousands of people are on H-1Bs. How many companies get audited? So, but in UK, because it's a small jurisdiction, the auditing is very high. And if it gets audited, then the employer owner gets in trouble. The visas for the employees get terminated and they will be sent back.
Here for tier two is different than the post-work visa?
Yes. Post-work visa is something like an OPT, and tier two visa is something like an H-1B.
So the dependents who come, they work for a tier two visa, or for the dependents, it would be a different visa?
It's a dependent visa for tier two visa guys. They can also work there. Students visas, spouses can work, and tier two visa spouses can also work. They have a right to work. That's another beauty in UK.
So Kaviti Garu, like you have law firms all over the world. You have in UK, you have in New York, New Jersey, Delhi, Hyderabad, Canada, like you have in all over the places. So which country, like you think, like it's for, especially for Indians, is easier to get into as a student?
I would say UK is easy, and Australia is tough, and New Zealand is tough. Canada is getting it harder now. I guess US is the toughest, I would say. It's more, UK is more relaxed. But, you know, when you see opportunities of employment, US have excellent opportunities. You don't have that big opportunity because there's no manufacturing industry in UK. Whereas if you see the IT companies, almost all the headquarters are in America. And if you see medicine, there's a potential now. The doctors and the nurses are required in UK, and the medical professions have a good future in UK. And for IT, I would say best is America, because most of the IT companies from America, they go and set up in UK, and there are not major IT companies over there. So industry is very less in UK. If you say in that way, I would say US is the best, but it has got its hardship of getting visas for H-1 lottery system, and only 20,000 for master quotas, and all over the world, 190 country people are competing with H-1, 60,000, and waiting for the green card is long list. But employment is there in US, 50 states. It's the biggest continent. So, you know, every country has a checks and balances. I mean, you know, some countries are, some things are better. If you see weather, it's very cold around the year. It's very cloudy in UK, a lot of rain all the time. People get depressed in UK. But when you see America, if you see Florida and some states, beautiful sunshine, Texas sunshine, Atlanta. So, you know, every country has its checks and balances. But in terms of education, these are all English-speaking countries. I would say US is the, you know, large economy, and UK is a smaller economy. And Australia is also opening up a lot of doors. We do immigration to Australia as well, but they're also making it very difficult for student visas and work permits and PRs. New Zealand is also now, struggling with the economy. A lot of people are leaving New Zealand and coming to Australia. And, you know, it's got checks and balances. Every country has goods and bads, and it depends upon what you want. Nowadays, Europe is also giving a lot of work permits to Indians, engineers, doctors, and other professionals. Accountants also after COVID, because if you see, Brussels or Belgium or Poland and all other these countries, European countries, after COVID, a lot of factory workers are also going. You know, if you see Israel, a lot of construction workers are going. So it depends upon what is your background and where you want to settle.
Yeah, thank you so much, English solicitor, Dr. Srinivas Kaviti Garu, for taking your time and discussing all about the student visas, especially about UK. This is a less known topic for most of the people. Most of them know about US visas, but not on UK visas. So thank you so much for taking your time. Thank you, viewers. This is Priya Goteti signing off.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.